are back now, coming up on midnight here in the East. Donald Trump, let's take a look at the map right now. Donald Trump has a lead, 244 electoral votes to 209 for Hillary Clinton. You need 270 to win. You see the states out there right now. For Hillary Clinton to win, she basically has to run the table right now. Donald Trump is ahead in most of those states right now. Matthew Dowd, this is really something. We could have one of the biggest upsets ever in American history coming up.
Regardless of the final outcome, which I think heavily leans in Donald Trump's favor, this is the biggest political upset news story in 100 years, in at least 100 years. Donald Trump, not favored to win against 16 opponents, comes through the primaries, wins the primary, everybody discounts him, comes into a general election totally behind, against a machine that had all the establishment, all of it, including the Republican establishment, basically either silently or vocally against him. And he's about, not yet, but he's on the verge of pulling off. And I think we're going to look back at this. It's more so than any other election, presidential election, that we've seen in our lifetimes, but go back 100, 150 years.
Let's go to Nate Silver right now. Nate Silver, you had your forecast coming into the night like so many others. In fact, you were more cautious on Hillary Clinton victory than many others, but you still had it above 70%. You've had this dramatic change as the results have come in overnight.
Well, we were a lot more cautious because of the scenario that's unfolding now, which is that if she underperforms in the Midwest, she could lose the Electoral College despite winning the popular vote. She will probably win the popular vote once California and the West Coast is counted, but there are a lot of swing states in the Midwest if you lose Wisconsin, which has not been called yet, but probably will be if we're being honest. She can maybe hold Michigan, Pennsylvania, and get to a 269-269 tie. But when you lose Ohio and Iowa by 3 to 5 points, when Michigan is in jeopardy, her voters are concentrated just on the coasts, and she'll have plenty of votes. She'll get a lot of votes, maybe more votes than Donald Trump, but that leads to not her winning the White House.
No, that's that. And where is your projection right now? Can you put it up there again?
So right now, we have Clinton with a 20% chance, but that's without Wisconsin having been called. When Wisconsin's called, she either has to basically win Arizona, or there are some ties, some 269-269 ties. They involve her running the table that would go to the House of Representatives, potentially. You know, not even that much of a reward for Clinton there, because the House would probably be Republican. But if she ran the table, it could be a tie, is maybe her best hope, unless there's a lot of vote we aren't accounting for in Wisconsin or Arizona somehow swings her way.
Let's take another look at the states that are still out there. John Carl, let's start with Wisconsin.
I keep stranger things have happened, but I don't know if stranger things have happened. I mean, just to Matthew's point of, you know, covering this race, the chances this guy would be the Republican nominee were astronomically small, and then this. It's just unbelievable. So you wanted to go to Wisconsin. Wisconsin, Donald Trump's lead is actually expanding in the state of Wisconsin, 4 points next door in Michigan. It's tight, but I tell you, I've looked at this, 48-47. Hillary Clinton is underperforming in Wayne County, which is Detroit. She is underperforming in Wayne County. Clearly, the big city vote, the African-American vote in Michigan is not turning out for Hillary Clinton.
And since Nate Silver mentioned it, let's take a look quickly at Arizona, because Arizona, Donald Trump has a lead there.
Arizona, Donald Trump has a lead. It's only a 3-point lead, but 63% reporting. It's closer than you would have expected in previous cycles, but it's highly unlikely that she's going to win the state of Arizona.
Cokie Roberts, astonishing.
It is astonishing. I will say this about Arizona. They have voted to increase the minimum wage, and maybe some of the same people voting to increase the minimum wage are also voting for Hillary Clinton. So it could be surprising there, but it would be a surprise.
Okay.
It is.
And in Arizona tonight also, Joe Arpaio has lost.
The sheriff,
free to be
strong supporter of Donald Trump.
And okay. John McCain has won.
Okay, John McCain has won right there. We are just moments away from midnight. I have to take another quick break. Crucial point in this race, all eyes on Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. We'll be right back.
Live in Times Square, here again, George Stephanopoulos.
It is midnight here on the East Coast, and Donald Trump is racking up the victories. He now has 244 electoral votes to 209 for Hillary Clinton, only needs 26 more to get the 270 he needs to become the next president of the United States. Tom Yamas, what are you hearing from inside their camp?
We just got a really good piece of information from our intrepid embed who's been covering Donald Trump from the start, John Santucci. He gets this from a senior level source. Donald Trump, for the first time tonight, has left the war room. He's gone up to his penthouse in Trump Tower, and he said he needed a moment with his wife. While this is happening, Trump Tower, I'm told, is exploding in a good way. They think this is their night. And just thinking with this political team here, you know, looking back at this campaign, if you break it down on a simple level, you know, Matt Dowd and Karl Rove, they had this amazing operation with the Bush campaign where they were crunching numbers, and the Obama campaign had this amazing digital operation that Terry covered, you know, micro-targeting different people. And when I think about Donald Trump, he essentially won this race by labeling people. He labeled Jeb Bush low energy. You know, he had an important message, but this is how he killed his opponents. Lying Ted, Lil Marco, and of course, Crooked Hillary. And as I think about labels right now, I'm also thinking about a title we haven't said yet, and the night's not over. But think about this, President Trump.
President Trump would be the 45th if he indeed does win. Now, we're paying attention to three key states right now, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. Let's take a look at them one by one. John Carl, let's start out with the state of Michigan.
Start out with the state of Michigan. Donald Trump clinging to a very small lead, but it is a lead, and you now have 64% of the vote in.
About a 50,000 vote lead right there right now.
And you go next door to the state of Wisconsin, and Donald Trump has a larger lead, 76% of the vote in. We zoom back out and we go over to the state of Pennsylvania. Here is one where we have essentially a tie. We have about 4,000 vote lead out of 5 million votes cast.
But Donald Trump does not need Pennsylvania. If he wins Wisconsin and Michigan, he becomes the next president of the United States.
I just want to go back to what we were saying earlier this evening about what the appeal of Donald Trump was in these places, in the rural areas. And it was, he gives those voters hope. They may not believe that he can really change anything, but he is their hope and change candidate. They rejected Hillary Clinton in those areas. They want the man who promises them. Even if he can't deliver on those promises, he's their man.
He's their guy.
There's no question, and let's just dive in. Look at this, U.S. wrong track, and we saw that earlier. You know, if you think it's on the wrong track, you go with Donald Trump. This is interesting, too, Supreme Court. If you thought Supreme Court appointments were important, you went with Donald Trump. And to get back to what Tom Yamas was saying, you know, he said he went with labels, you know, lying Ted and low-energy Jeb. I just wonder how much of all of these big Republican establishment names, like the Bush family, saying they would not vote for Donald Trump, and a number of others, John Kasich in Ohio, how much that also fueled these voters who felt left behind in rural America. I would have to imagine a lot of these voters said, you know what, I don't care what the establishment's going to do, I found my man.
Cecilia Vega.
Well, also I'm sitting here just surprised by the fact that we are all surprised by this in a campaign that has been nothing but surprises. How many times have all of us sat around a table and said, I can't believe that just happened? From the very first time Donald Trump came out of the gate and basically offended all Latinos by calling Mexicans, some of them rapists, to Muslim ban, to a deportation force, to not denouncing the KKK fast enough. The list goes on and on and on. And yet here we are surprised by where he is. It's just pointed to me that it's been a campaign of oh my gods.
Charlie Gibson, my thoughts go right now to the White House. Barack Obama in the White House right now, Michelle Obama in the White House right now. They poured everything they had into this in the final weeks. President Obama, going back to that White House Correspondents' Dinner, what was it, 3 years ago, showed nothing but contempt for Donald Trump. This is a repudiation in some ways of him as well.
Terry and I were just talking about the fact, can you imagine if Donald Trump wins this thing, that ride up to the Capitol on January 20th for the inauguration with Barack Obama sitting next to Donald Trump in the limousine going up there. They'll go up there together and it will be a pretty frosty ride. You know, Tom said something at the beginning of the evening which I think is fascinating. What an incredibly non-traditional campaign this was. It was Donald Trump with a microphone, a hat, and an airplane.
Twitter account.
And a Twitter account.
And a lot of media exposure.
And
media is a good point. Media is a very good point. We haven't talked about the media. Donald Trump talked about, Tom certainly knows this personally,
every night
that we weren't telling the truth, that we were the corrupt media, that don't believe whatever you hear. apparently a lot of people bought right into that.
Donald Trump came to this campaign. He might not have had a traditional campaign by any stretch, but he came to this campaign with a skill set. He was a television performer. He had The Apprentice. He had other ventures. This was something that he brought that no one really could match. None of those establishment Republicans during those debates across from you and me, Martha, you know, Donald Trump was the best performer on that stage, and he knocked them all off the stage.
You know, I was thinking, George, about trying to reflect on when is the last time in our history that we've had a moment like this that somebody like Donald Trump showed up. And the closest I can get is Andrew Jackson, which was 1828, when he basically was the populist. Everybody was against him. They thought he was a crazy man. What was he going to do to the White House? Who was he going to invite over? There was no way he should be president of the United States, including all of his party didn't want him to be president. He won.
Let's take a look back at the states. This still isn't decided yet. We do have 244 electoral votes for Donald Trump, 209 for Hillary Clinton. Let's start with the state of New Hampshire this time. John Carl, what are we seeing there?
By the way, I've got to share something with you first. A tweet from David Plouffe, who was, of course, the architect of Barack Obama's win in 2008.
Thought Hillary Clinton couldn't lose.
Yeah, absolutely. He said, never been as wrong on anything in my life. He says there's still a beating heart in Wisconsin. He still doesn't know if it's over, but he has never been as wrong as anything. I think that is...
He's not alone.
He's not alone. Which state did you want to go to?
Let's go to New Hampshire.
Let's go to New Hampshire. This is another one. We have 77% reported, and Donald Trump continues to lead in the state of New Hampshire.
And Michigan?
Michigan, still tight, but again, Donald Trump with a more than 50,000 vote advantage in the state of Michigan. Next door, state of Wisconsin, Donald Trump, the lead, if anything, is expanding. And I looked back, most of the vote is in Dane County, most of the vote is in Milwaukee. There's not a lot of more Democratic votes to mine in the state
of Wisconsin. We haven't checked in on Minnesota in a while. What's happening in Minnesota and Nevada?
Minnesota, Hillary Clinton's got a lead, a pretty formidable lead with 70% in. She's up 6 points. Out in Nevada, Hillary Clinton has a solid 6-point lead with 70% reported.
And Pennsylvania?
And Pennsylvania, tight. Look at that. Look at that, George. Donald Trump is back in the lead in the state of Pennsylvania by about 8,000 votes.
So he's ahead in Pennsylvania, ahead in Michigan, ahead in New Hampshire, ahead in Wisconsin right now.
It's looking like a Trump victory.
Just a little note from overseas, not quite overseas, over the northern border. The Canadian government's immigration website crashed tonight. after Barbara Streisand and Brian Cranston, a lot of other people said that if Donald Trump wins, they'd move to Canada. Type in, you can try it yourself. It crashed tonight. It was overloaded. So the international shockwaves have already started.
I want to come back to what we're talking about. You cannot give him enough credit for doing this, for pulling this off. And I don't want to be a Debbie Downer, but one of the things that's so dismaying that we saw all through this is people can't talk to each other anymore. They don't. They walk away from conversations with each other because the feelings are so heated. And no matter who wins this thing, that's not going away. The deep divisions have divided us as a country, and that hurts.
And that's going to be a big challenge for whoever becomes the next president. I want to go back to Pennsylvania right now. Deborah Roberts is in Johnstown, Pennsylvania right now. What are you seeing? You were among a lot of Trump supporters early this evening.
Well, there were a lot of Trump supporters. It was a pretty raucous crowd, but now we are down to the faithful few here, George, who are just biting their nails. I asked them just now if they think that this is over, and a couple of them said, no, it's not over until it's over. But they thought a week or two ago that there was something going on here. The head of the county Republican Party said to us, we think that we're onto something. We think that we're seeing something we haven't seen before. And also tonight, they saw a state Senate race go to a Republican, a race that hadn't gone to a Republican in more than 30 years. So the folks here feel like that they are speaking. These are heavily Trump supporters. And you got to remember, jobs, jobs, jobs. This is an area that was hit hard by the collapse of the steel industry. And even some of the women here who said that they did reluctantly vote for Donald Trump today said, at the end of the day, jobs trump everything. That's what they said to us, George. So a lot of nervous folks here still waiting, but I think they're feeling pretty confident, but they say it's not over, of course, until it's
Donald
over.
Donald Trump is holding on in Pennsylvania right now. Martha Raddatz, you spent a lot of time there.
I certainly did. And I have to say, I'm not surprised in those areas where Deborah is, not surprised at all because of the anger. The mayor who I drove around with 2 days ago in Pennsylvania And we went through these areas and he was showing me all the Trump signs, maybe one or two Hillary Clinton signs. Their town, Manesson, Pennsylvania, has gone from 25,000, it's a steel mill town, down to 7,500. People have moved out, they've given up, they don't have jobs. And he is the one who kept saying, I don't care what Donald Trump says. One other thing I want to bring up, George, and that is whoever wins tonight will not only be president, they will be commander-in-chief. Not only just commander-in-chief, but we are still at war in Iraq. We are still at war in Afghanistan, and that is going to be immediate. I've been talking to a lot of military in the last couple of days, texting them back and forth, and it really is kind of across the board. But I think Donald Trump was probably far more popular in the military than even the general population, because that's the place if you want to find working class white males, it's in the military. I think I'm getting some things
between the rank and file and the generals.
I think there's kind of a split there, in the same as in society. Now, no active duty general is going to tell me who they're voting for. The military has already become pretty politicized this year, which is distressing to some people. But there is a split, and there are. I was just listening to someone. He said, "Look, I like Donald Trump. I like what he says. I'm worried about the Second Amendment. It's all the messaging that Donald Trump has done has gone."
Let's keep an eye on the states right now as they continue to come in. The vote continues to come in. Let's go out west, John Carl. Let's go out to the south. Let's start out with Arizona and then go to Nevada.
Okay, Arizona. Trump has a solid lead with about 2/3 of the vote in, 3-point lead over Hillary Clinton. Nevada, Hillary Clinton has a solid lead of about 5 points. Neither one of those are particularly surprising. To dig down into Pennsylvania, where we see the lead kind of going back and forth right now, Trump up. One thing I would point out, George, is if you look out here in Pittsburgh, this is Allegheny County. This is a county that is overwhelmingly Democratic, and if you look, only 25% of the vote is in Allegheny County. So that will be a lot more Democratic votes coming in. But another county
But Donald Trump, we should emphasize, Donald Trump can afford to lose Pennsylvania.
Donald Trump can absolutely afford to win Pennsylvania. It's shocking that we are here this close. And one other place that's interesting in Pennsylvania is Luzerne County, which is a county that if you look back in 2012, Barack Obama won quite handedly. This is steel country, this is coal country, and look at Donald Trump winning by 20 points in a county that Barack Obama won just 4 years ago.
Cecilia Vega.
George, we're just hearing from a donor to the Clinton campaign, a top donor. I want to read you this quote that has just come to me, quote, done, over, he is the president.
This is from a Clinton donor.
Clinton donor.
There we have it. So we hear.
We have not heard from anybody in the campaign. We have not heard from anybody in the campaign. There's still radio silence, and I'm told by my colleagues who were there in the room at the Javis Center right now that there are no aides to be seen. We know the last we've heard that Hillary Clinton was working on a speech, that her aides were working on a speech in a hotel room in New York. But again, to read it to you one more time, this stark words from a top donor to the Clinton campaign: "Quote, done, over. He is the president."
If Wisconsin goes for Trump, and if Maine too, that one congressional, one of the two congressional districts in Maine that has, which cast the electoral vote, I think that is gone now for Trump. That's 270. So Pennsylvania and Michigan are very interesting, and he could have a big margin if he wins those two in the electoral college. But all he needs is Arizona, Wisconsin, and Maine too, to get to, someone should double check this, but I'm pretty sure about this math, to 270. And that's why I think if you look at Arizona and Wisconsin, they look pretty strong for Trump.
We talked this morning to take up on something Martha said and Cecilia was mentioning is about the being president-elect. There was a talk, and I said this morning, there's two historical things will get broken, either a glass ceiling for a first woman president or the first president who had no political experience or no military experience. And so whatever that resume ceiling or whatever we call it, the paper resume ceiling, he's about to bust through that no president in the history of the country has ever done. They've either had military experience or political experience, and he hasn't either.
That's right. We've had generals and elected officials become president before. Both you, Bill Kristol, and you, Matthew Dodd, have worked with Republican presidents and Republican White House. And I just want to pose this question to you right now. We're still waiting for these other states to come in. But as we said, Donald Trump now has multiple paths. He calls you up tomorrow morning and says, what should I do? What is his number one job?
Well, I'll have to withdraw my application to go to Canada. I was worried I couldn't get through on the website there, but I guess it's crashed. his number one job is to unite the country. He needs to make a gracious speech tonight before tomorrow, I think, and really reach out to those who didn't vote for him. I mean, that's traditionally what presidents do. It's traditionally what losing candidates do. I assume Secretary Clinton, assuming she loses, will do something like that. I think it's extremely important, the tone of Donald Trump's speech tonight. It doesn't make up, in my view. I mean, whatever it makes up for, it doesn't. If he's the president-elect, he's the president-elect. I think there will be a certain amount of goodwill, even among those who have very strongly opposed him and thought he wasn't the right person to become president, because you've got to hope your president succeeds.
I would add, I agree with that, but I think one of the things he really needs to do, including among his supporters, is he needs to reassure them that he is going to be, he's going to be surrounded with people in the White House that they have a degree of confidence in, that something isn't going to go out of control. Even his own supporters worry about his temperament and worry about his ability to be commander-in-chief. So I think he quickly needs to demonstrate who is going to be around him.
Tom Yamas, quickly.
I respectfully disagree with my colleague Matt Dowd, just because if he wins tonight, it's a testament to himself. I did this by myself. A politician's job, if we take a jaded perspective, everyone knows this, a politician's job first day in office is to get reelected. But if Donald Trump looks at that map tonight and he wins by big margins, you know what he's going to do? Whatever he wants.
This might be the most stunning night in American political history. Donald Trump, 26 electoral votes away from the White House. We'll be right back.
Introducing the...
And we are back now, coming up on 20 minutes after midnight here on the East Coast, and Donald Trump is coming up on victory. It is not done yet, but he has 244 electoral votes to 209 for Hillary Clinton, shaping up to be one of the most, if not the most stunning upset in American political history. Cecilia Vega, you've been covering this Clinton campaign from the start. All through the final weekend, they were exuberant, they were exuding confidence. Is reality setting in?
Well, we're still not hearing from anyone directly inside the Clinton campaign. I am hearing from Democratic sources who and donors to the Clinton campaign who say that they believe that this race is over for Hillary Clinton right now. We still, like I just said, I want to emphasize, no one from the Clinton campaign has spoken publicly yet. In fact, the last tweet
we saw...
That's
a sign in and of itself.
That is a sign in and of itself, George. Hillary Clinton is notoriously superstitious. We've been talking about this all day. She had two speeches prepped and ready to go, one for either outcome, and she's been working on those speeches along with her aides all day and all night, and I guess we will know soon which one she delivers.
Tom Yamas, the exuberance continuing to grow in the Trump camp.
I think we're beyond that point now, George. Rudy Giuliani just met with reporters, and he's talking about the future, that they're going to start working starting tomorrow on Wednesday, the day after Election Day. They're calling the polls before the election, prejudice. The only irony of tonight, Donald Trump said the election is rigged. He may end up winning the rigged election.
Winning the rigged election. We'll see. We still have a lot of states out there. One of the things you're finding in these exit polls, David Muirhead, it picks up on the point of how personal a victory is for Donald Trump. A lot of his supporters voting for him, even though they disagree with him on big issues.
Yeah, it's a stunning thing. It sort of flies in the face of the findings so far on this election night. But look at this. A key question we always ask, which candidate is qualified to be president? The majority of Americans say only Hillary Clinton there, 46%. Look at this. The border wall, one of his key issues, if not the most important issue. 54% of Americans say they oppose any idea of a border wall. And look at this. Undocumented immigrants, a chance at legal status. 70% of Americans say they absolutely deserve that chance. Only 25% say they should be deported. But here's what it all boils down to. Look at this. The quality that matters most. 39% of Americans said the candidate who can bring change. And when we laser in on who that went to, 83% of American voters who wanted change went with Donald
Trump.
That
is the big vote right there. But Alex Osceola, let me bring that to you right there. I mean, Mexico's made it very clear they're not going to pay for any wall, even if Donald Trump wins. How does he bring that to his supporters? Or do they not even care?
Well, as far as Donald Trump, what we know about him is the art of the deal, right? Everything is a negotiating process, a position. And for too long, Americans voters have seen, they send people to Washington with their five-point plan, and that's where they start. Well, Donald Trump is the kind of a guy who's, I want to buy this car. You're going to charge $50,000, I'll give you $10,000. As long as there's a good faith effort to get things done, I think the American people understand that it's part of the process. And we'll give him, I think, some slack as long as we move things in a different direction. But I do want to point out one thing about what happened tonight. Peter Thiel, founder of PayPal, gave a big speech in Washington last week, and I think gave the best summary of what this election was all about. He said, I don't think voters pull the lever to endorse a candidate's flaws. We're voting for Trump because we judge the leadership of our country to have failed. The details on policy, how much of a wall, how high, that's not the big issue. Somebody's got to turn Washington around.
That is the big issue right now. Washington is broken. Someone has to fix it. Donald Trump, 26 electoral votes away from the presidency.
Remember 2000.
Welcome. You are joining ABC News' digital coverage of Election Night 2016 in progress. Thanks for being here with us. Shoshu had just posed a really interesting question to LZ.
So LZ, you're a Michigan native. And I'm wondering if you think there's enough vote in Detroit, which is counting slower than other parts of the state, to make it up for Hillary Clinton.
Well, you know, one of the big things about the revival about Detroit is that Detroit has fundamentally changed in terms of the residents. It is still 90% black, but a lot of those blacks are on the outskirts of where the revitalization is happening. And the internal inside the city is actually really white. In fact, I was at a conference and I spoke and I said, oh, the city has changed so much. Like, look, there's white people here and there's not a baseball game. You know, you're just here, just walking around.
Jump in for 1 second. Oh,
do we have a projection?
Now the state of Nevada, where Secretary Clinton has been shown to be the victor according to our projection. So that's a pretty key state for Hillary Clinton. Of course, she's got a long way to go given the nature of the map at this point. But at this point, we're calling her the projected winner in the state of Nevada. Next door is Arizona, which would be a massive electoral prize for her. And there are some indications, including the defeat of Sheriff Joe Arpaio, that she might have a chance there, but it's still it would be a reach given the state, given that it's traditionally a red state.
And that is one of the key states we're still keeping an eye on. Just a reminder, Michigan we have yet to call. I know you've got some thoughts and some good insight on that. We'll have that back in just a second. Wisconsin as well. Stay with us here. Guys, all of you out in TV land, thanks for joining us. Everyone else, stay with us. More continuing coverage in just a moment.
Wednesday, Modern Family's back.
And we are back on. We had a little audio glitch right there. Sorry about that. But the state of Nevada has gone to Hillary Clinton. 6 electoral votes, a lot of early vote there. She wins 49% to 45 right now. John Carl keeping her hopes alive, but they are slim hopes. She now has 215 electoral votes to 244 for Donald Trump.
Yeah, she's in a situation now, George, where she has to win. She has to basically run the table on these states in the industrial Midwest, including Pennsylvania in that, but she has to win Minnesota where she has a lead. She has to win Wisconsin where she is trailing. She has to win Michigan where she is trailing. She has to win Pennsylvania, which is right now almost a pure toss.
So she's got to win 2 states right now, 2 key states right now, Michigan and Wisconsin, where she is behind.
Yeah, and even so, you know, Donald Trump has some other paths here. If he wins in New Hampshire, He can win just the state of Wisconsin. Let's go to my possibilities board here because So if you look at this, these are the states outstanding. Trump's got a big lead in Arizona. Put that in his camp. So he's at 260 with Arizona. Wisconsin alone puts him at 270. He doesn't need anything else. And Michigan, of course, puts him well over 270.
And Pennsylvania
puts him well over. So he just needs to win one of the three.
Okay, that's what he's got right now. I want to go back to Rebecca Jarvis, our senior business correspondent. You're talking about the Dow futures before world markets are now open as well. Asian markets are open. What are we seeing?
We're seeing lower across the board, George. The Dow is now, as far as the futures market concerned, down more than 800 points. The S&P 500, which is what most Americans track their 401k to, futures of the S&P 500 are down 5%, which means if it were to open there tomorrow, the traditional 401k would be down about 5% tomorrow. And for a moment, the CME Group, which oversees the markets, halted trading in the S&P 500 because the stocks were down so much. That is extremely rare that we see things like that. It happened momentarily here. Now the market has bounced up a little bit, but still much lower.
Terry Moran, we're starting to see some world reaction come in as well. I want to pull it up here on my email. We saw the French ambassador to the United States. And we'll put up in a second, started saying this is a world we do not know anymore. That is starting to come in as well.
He said after Brexit, this election, anything is now possible. A world is crumbling before our eyes, and he's absolutely right. And it's the world that was once dubbed the New World Order, the world that was built after the Cold War, promoting not a borderless world, but a very open world in terms of trade and allowing money and capital and jobs and businesses to flow from country to country, and immigration. That is being rejected by people who believe, Trump voters would tell you, that the homeland counts more, that we need to secure our borders, get the jobs back, as Trump has said. This is a rejection of the neoliberal world order that really has been the consensus of governments across the West and across the world for a generation.
It seems, Tom Yamas, that Donald Trump hit again and again and again, repetition from that very first day in June 2015.
Oh, completely. It was what it carried him through the primaries and into the general election. We've just gotten some reporting also from Trump Tower. I wanted to update you, George. So we now understand that Donald Trump is in a wait and see approach. They're waiting for either two things to happen. One, obviously, someone calls the race that he's won, or two, he receives a call from Hillary Clinton. That's where they're at right now. That's where their mind's at right now.
Okay, let's take a look, John Carl, at the state of New Hampshire. What are we seeing there right now?
You ready for this, George? 15-vote margin. Donald Trump is winning the state of New Hampshire by 15 votes.
15 votes. How much is out?
81%.
Oh, so still a lot of votes left out there.
Yeah,
still a lot of
votes
there, but
yeah.
It's a 15-vote margin right now. Lots of close states out there right now as we go across this map. Matthew Dowd, this is a lot of similarities right now to Florida in 2000, but not necessarily depending on other states in the upper Midwest fall.
Well, I think Hillary Clinton would wish it was Florida 2000 at this point in time, because that was
as
a 200 votes. Yeah, it's Bush,
yeah.
If that was the case. I think we're going to have to grasp with a lot of things in the aftermath of this, the historical nature of it, unbelievable. But we have to, and one of the things I want to follow up with that was said earlier, is there was major poll problems in this election. Now, Hillary Clinton may end up winning the popular vote in this race, and it looks like she probably will win the popular vote. So the national polls may be not far off, but every single state poll, every single public state poll, most of the polls done by the Hillary campaign.
Well, that's what I want to tell you. It's not just the public polls. Listen, we all do a lot of reporting. We were reporting with the Democratic campaigns. We were reporting with the Republican campaigns. We were reporting with the Senate campaigns.
I talked to both sides, both the Democratic side and the Trump side. And almost we're all in consensus that it was almost impossible at that point. Their Trump side had a rout, but they thought it was almost impossible for him to win in the last 48 hours. And he's about to win.
And Republicans in Washington were convinced that he was going to lose. And they were telling this to us quite candidly. They were convinced that he was going to lose.
Right. The question is there any way to have gotten this right? If you look at what the ABC pre-election poll showed compared to the exit polls, the proportion of voters who are these non-college white men, they got the sample right. It's the proportion saying that they'd vote for Trump that was wrong. And so there was this question, social desirability bias. Is it socially unacceptable to say that you would vote for Donald Trump? That may be the problem. And what's tough for the polling industry is you can fix sampling error. You can't fix when people don't want to tell you the truth. And that's a big problem for the polling world.
Alex.
No, I think if you couldn't figure out in this election that it was uncool to publicly support Donald Trump and tell somebody, you weren't paying attention, or you didn't have a phone or a television set. And I think that's it, social desirability bias. John Kerry, right, George Bush, 2004, The exit polls had Kerry winning by 6, he lost by 2. We may have had as big an effect this year.
Stephanie.
On the John Kerry comparison, the exit polls were wrong, but the internal data was not wrong.
Yeah, and Bush, I think the Bush data was we ended up exactly where we
and,
were.
And we were pretty darn close. And I just want to address one thing, the social undesirability of stating that you're for Trump. There's a reason for that. It's not because his message was hopeful. It's because his message was divisive. Well, Make America Great Again was a dog whistle for keeping immigrants out, for keeping your foot down on people, for discriminating against women, for sexual assault,
only,
all of these things that Trump became about. But Alex, remember the most powerful ad against Donald Trump were the ads that used his own words. So nobody was twisting those facts.
I'm not going to argue that Donald Trump made it difficult to defend him.
These are things that were said about Republicans in elections after election. Everybody said that Mitt Romney was racist and sexist.
No, not John McCain. Come on, Donald Trump
was racist and sexist with his language. That's the problem.
I don't disagree with you, Kristen, but you have to agree with me that this is of a different sort.
I want to go back to the States.
So I just want to call it what it is.
That's why he won.
Okay, I'm going to call this one right now. We're going to come back. We're going to have plenty of time for this later. I want to go back to the state of Nevada right now. Jim Avila, that is one place where Hillary Clinton supporters have not yet given up. They just had that win in the state.
That's right, George. And in fact, just a few moments ago, when the state was, in fact, called for Hillary Clinton, there was a great deal of chanting, yes, we can, and Hillary were being chanted in the room. Died down a little bit. Of course, it's only 6 electoral votes here. This was a very, nationwide, they're very disappointed, of course, because this was one of those states, when the battleground states, where Latinos were expected to have a surge. And apparently there was a Latino surge here that helped Nevada win. But across the country, that Latino surge has been ineffective. It hasn't won. We've been talking about anger all night long. Anger from working white people and the working class. There is also a great deal of anger tonight among Latinos. I've been getting messages all night long from Latinos in their advocacy groups, and now they've been turning not just to anger but to fear, George. There is a real fear among Latinos in this country right now because it appears to them that Donald Trump is going to win. And not only just fear about being about their relatives being deported or that there be ICE squads walking around the neighborhoods looking for undocumented immigrants. This also a fear that they are being marginalized, that people of color, Hispanics, Muslims, blacks, that they'll be now ostracized and not important. What are the chances now, really, if Donald Trump wins? What are the chances of true immigration reform? Even though those exit polls say today that most of Americans who voted today actually favor a path to citizenship, but they also favor a huge wall. And that wall is very fearful and a symbol of marginalization in this country that Americans of color are feeling, especially Latinos tonight.
If he becomes president, it certainly would be a Nixon goes to China moment. Let's go back to the maps right now. Let's take a look at Pennsylvania right now. Very, very, very close.
Pennsylvania is close, and we have 93% of the vote in, George. Donald Trump is clinging to a very narrow lead, but it is a lead with 90% of the votes in. And earlier I mentioned to you that we were waiting for votes from Allegheny County, which is out there in Pittsburgh. Take a look at it now. 98% of Allegheny County is in. So again, there's not a lot of votes left for Hillary Clinton.
So he's leading in Michigan, leading in Pennsylvania, leading in Wisconsin.
That's right. Leading in 3 states. He only needs to win one of them.
You talked about Jim Avila there. He talked about the Hispanic vote, and there were so many headlines in this last week about awaking a sleeping giant. When you talk about building the wall, about a deportation force early on in the campaign, I think what was missed is that he awoke another sleeping giant, and that is the uneducated white men in this country who heard someone who spoke to them. And that's what we're seeing with 49 points. I mean, that's a record. The biggest record going back to 1980 is an 11-point gap with non-college educated white men. We're looking at 49 points between Trump and Clinton tonight.
We're seeing gender gaps in some of these states, the likes of which we've never seen before. 30-some points in some states. And it is another place where you're going to see a sense of being left out. So if you have African Americans voting by 89% for Clinton and Hispanic Americans voting for her by 66-67% and women voting for her, you've got this incredible divide that's not just a partisan divide. It's a divide among groups of people who are going to feel very, very hostile to each other.
In both groups of people around the country and in Washington as well. Byron Pitts, I see you want to get in on this.
George, I'm confused at this moment tonight.
Join the club.
Right? Because I went to an all-boys Catholic high school in Baltimore, made up mostly of blue-collar kids. And I've been talking to a number of my classmates tonight. Many of them went to college, many didn't. Many of them own small businesses. And they see it as, once again in America, the underdog has won. And that's a good thing, because that's very much an American quality, right? That the underdog has won, right? Then I talked to many of my friends of color and women, because oftentimes in America, if you're a person of color, you're told if you get an education, get a good job, prepare yourself, you can be as successful as anyone else in America. And in this case, you had a woman who was on paper as prepared as anyone could be to be the president, and she lost to, forgive me, a white guy with a haircut. And so you have those two.
Let's add to the layer of confusion. Let me bring this to Tom Yamas as well. You have the champion of working class America that's been stuck for a generation without an income increase, is a man who inherited an awful lot of money, parlayed that into success in reality TV and branding hotels, lived as far removed a life from that life as you could possibly imagine.
George, you have a billionaire who lives in a penthouse in Manhattan, connecting with the Midwest, people who are nowhere near his economic level. His message resonated with these people so well, and he really never adapted his look or sort of changed his style. He wore that suit everywhere. He'd throw on the hat sometime if he was going into a really, you know, maybe sort of, I don't know how to describe it, but an area where there's a lot of hunting, he would throw on a camouflage Make America Great Again hat. And that was the only adaptation of his gear when he'd get out there. He never lost that jacket. He played golf every Sunday. But it is incredible that his message connected with those people.
And I want to add to this layer of confusion and bring this one to Matthew Dowd. He connected in a way, just as Tom Yamas is saying, and there's just no question about that. People saw him as authentic, as a truth teller, even though if you look at the nonpartisan examinations of the claims he would make on any given day, and they say by 5-1, he was making untruthful statements.
Well, I think there was a famous thing said that his voters didn't take him literally, but they took him seriously, right? So many people laughed at, said there's no way he can do that. His voters thought, oh no, he's serious. But the bad things he said, oh, no, he doesn't really mean that. I think what they finally decided was they've been frustrated at both political parties. This is not a reward for the Republican Party. They're frustrated at both political parties. And they said, give us the biggest, brashest guy, and we're going to follow him. And he's representing us. He's given us a voice that we haven't had in years. We didn't have it with George W. Bush. We didn't have it with Barack Obama. And we forgot what happened with Bill Clinton. And give us that big, brash, in many ways, bully. And he's going to go to Washington, and he's going to represent me.
He's not there yet, but he is closing in. What's happening in the state of Wisconsin, John Carl?
Wisconsin is still a solid Trump lead, but I, you know, do need to caution you that there are still Democratic votes to come in. We mentioned Dane County, home of Madison, 81% reporting. It's solidly Democratic, so there's still votes there. There are still votes in Milwaukee. But if you look overall at the state, you know, Trump's got a 3 percentage point lead. I would also look next door in the state of Michigan, and Trump is still at a lead. He's had a lead all night in Michigan. And we've been waiting on Wayne County, which Matthew and I were talking about. Wayne County, which is Detroit, 85% is in, so they're starting to run out of Democratic votes.
And New Hampshire?
And New Hampshire is tight. Let's see where we are now. Donald Trump has expanded his 15-vote lead. He now has a more sizable lead with 81% reporting.
81. Cokie?
On all of these ballot measures around the country, they're all going very liberally. Marijuana is getting legalized every place. The minimum wage is going up every place. Assisted suicide, I don't know whether that's a liberal or a conservative idea, but it's certainly one that is opposed by many churches, and that is passing. So it is this very bifurcated result here in terms of what people are actually saying.
You separate out the issue of the wall, the issue of the ban on Muslims. There wasn't much of a necessary coherent agenda put forward by Donald Trump, but I think I want to bring this one to Terry Moran. But if he is indeed elected with a Republican House, perhaps with a Republican Senate, he will be adopting the agenda that they have put on the table. That's what Paul Ryan was saying all along.
Right.
Well, good luck, Paul Ryan, A, retaining your speakership, and B, imposing your will on Donald Trump. As Tom pointed out, this is a personal victory unlike any we've ever had in American politics, except for maybe George Washington. And the thing that is Trump's ideology, he's not a liberal, he's not a conservative, he's a nationalist. Make America Great Again is a nationalist slogan. And what counts for the people who voted for him, it seems to me, is that he wants to make America great again. They get a sense that people in this city, in New York City, a lot of them, have more in common with their counterparts, if they're in finance or media or whatever, in Frankfurt, in London, in Hong Kong, than they do with their cousins in Albany. And what they want is bring America home again. And I think that's his agenda.
I want to go to Mary Bruce in Janesville, Wisconsin. That is, of course, the home of Paul Ryan. Number one on the agenda for Paul Ryan, repealing Obamacare and perhaps a big infrastructure bill.
Absolutely. But you make a good point, Terry, just now, that just because Donald Trump may win, that does not mean that Paul Ryan is in the clear here. Remember, he has had that very, very tense relationship with Donald Trump. Donald Trump has called him weak, ineffective. Donald Trump was made very clear his views about Paul Ryan when Paul Ryan first went public with his announcement that he was no longer going to defend or campaign for Donald Trump. You can still expect, even if Donald Trump does win, that that relationship could still continue to be quite tense for quite some time.
But we do not have a winner yet. Donald Trump has 244 electoral votes, 215 for Hillary Clinton. Race not over. One slim path for Hillary Clinton. All eyes on Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania. But Donald Trump ahead in those states right now. We're live with the latest results when we come back.
Back live in Times Square after this.